Good morning. Welcome to Bible Fellowship Church. Thank you for joining us today as we take some time to celebrate Paul's life. And we also want you to know when our time is over, we're going to invite you to come and join us in the fellowship hall. We also have some 3x5 cards that are in there that the family has asked if you wouldn't mind just to write down maybe one of your favorite memories of Paul. And just place it in that box, and the family will collect that when our time is done. And so we're going to open a prayer, and then we're going to turn it over to the family. We have a couple of people that are going to share. And so again, thank you for being with us. Jesus, I thank you for our community and the outpouring of love for Paul's life. I thank you for the gifts and abilities that you gave to him, and that the individuals that are sitting in this room today have been blessed by him. And so as we do celebrate his life, we ask Jesus that you would give us strength and you would give us wisdom. How do we support his family? How do we encourage them as they continue on? And so help us, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen.
Oh, I have stage fright, so, but bear with me. First, on behalf of my family, I want to express our heartfelt gratitude to each and every one of you for joining us here today. Your presence means a lot to us, and it's evident how deeply our dad was cared for. While we might not be familiar with everyone in this room, and we may not fully grasp the extent of Dad's influence on your lives, we are truly grateful for your presence and your support. Those who knew our dad well understood his humility. He always went above and beyond for others without seeking recognition for anything in return. He always hid away from praise and the limelight. Although he might have been angry with today's service because he never thought he was deserving of something like this, it's undeniable that he deserves every bit of celebration and acknowledgement for the remarkable person he was. I only wish he could see the immense impact and affection that people have for him. I want to thank you all once again for being here today to honor his memory. This one's from me. Dad, I prayed for strength to stand here today, but the pain in my heart is beyond words. A piece of my heart has been ripped away in a way that I could never have imagined. Growing up, all I ever wanted to do was make you proud. You set the bar so high and pushed me to reach even higher. As an adult, you never stopped believing in me, always dreaming of my success no matter what I did. When I joined the sheriff's office back in 2018, you always saw potential in me, even suggesting that I could become sheriff one day if I ever wanted. You believed and pushed me so much because you would tell me that I'm a Robitelli. And being a Robitelli means limitless potential and strength. When I started working with you 6 years ago, you had to now become P. Robitelli. And they started calling you Proby, a nickname you tolerated only for my sake because you loved that we worked together. I then became Little Robo or Robo Jr. or other nicknames. I used to joke with you and say that I was the number one Robitelli of the jail because A is before P in the alphabet. And you'd laugh and you'd tell me that you made me, so you will always be number one. And you were right. So much of who I am comes from you, and everybody who knows me and knows you always says it. I used to resent being called your twin and how I look just like you because I'm a girl. But now I struggle to look in the mirror because I see you and me. I have your attitude, your quirky remarks, and your slick mouth. My uniform bears your name, and I don't know if I'll ever wear it again without feeling lost like I do today. My children will never experience the joy of knowing you, and that breaks my heart. You raised me to be strong, to hold my head high, and walk like I am never afraid. And I want to make sure that I pass those lessons on to my children. I could talk for hours and hours about my dad. But one thing I want to say to everyone that's here today is you never truly know the battles that someone is fighting. My dad was a master of disguise, hiding his struggles from all of us. I now realize how much mental health matters. So to everyone here today, please, if you're ever hurting, reach out. Please check on those people who seem to have it all together, who seem like they're happy that their life's in order. Those could be the ones carrying the heaviest burdens. Dad, I wish we would have known your struggles so we could have tried to save you. Just know that I promise to be there for others who need me. Once again, to everyone here, thank you for loving my dad. Your kind words and support mean everything to us during this tragedy. Please let my dad live on through your stories of him and keep a piece of him in your heart. Dad, I hope you found peace and comfort in the arms of angels and that you watch over us all. I love you then, now, and forever. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I wish we could have all gathered here today under different circumstances. My family is in disbelief, and by speaking to every one of you guys, you all feel the same. We are grateful and so appreciative for for all the love and support we have received during this time. I do believe we all have the same thing to say about our dad, and that's that he was always there, whether it was to help or needing some advice or just a listening ear. Our dad could be counted on. Our dad is an amazing father, a supporting husband, a caring son, a loving sibling, a rock star grandpa, and a devoted friend. He worked so hard in life to make sure his family was taken care of and didn't ever have to go without. Our dad had such a huge heart and could see the good in everyone. Standing here today, I can clearly see he has touched many hearts. Not only us as his family, but you all as well will now have a void in your life. I worked with my dad and loved every second. I got to see him, whether it was him greeting us all into the courthouse, jamming out to his music, or hearing him laugh all the way upstairs as I sat at my desk and giving him a quick call to find out what could possibly be so funny. To surprising him with mints and Celsius drinks every week, to getting him lunch, to simply just wanting to talk to him on my breaks. My dad and I had a special bond. He would always say at work, "There's my daughter," and give me a hug or a kiss. I will miss my dad immensely. And my work will never feel the same. Ever since my sisters and I were little kids, we have always had this joke about being my dad's favorite. So, of course, that kept going into adulthood. I would always tell my dad, "I know I'm your favorite," and have a huge smile on my face. My dad would smile and say, "I am definitely in the top three." So, Jesse and Ashley, y'all ran a good race, and congratulations on getting second and third place. There would be many times I would go visit my parents' house on the weekends to see them both, just for my mom to tell me, "Your dad's working." Our dad was, as many of you know, a workaholic. He had retirement goals. For him and my mom, and wanted to travel the world when the time came. He even talked about taking turns and bringing each of his grandsons out on adventures. To say the least, our dad loved and wanted nothing but the absolute best for his family. He will be loved and always cherished in our hearts. And at this time, I would also like to say to my Uncle Matt that Dad sees everything you're doing, and there is no doubt that he has been giving you the biggest big brother hugs ever. You sent me a message the other day that said, "I will always be a phone call away. I plan to fill his shoes as much as I can. I know they're big shoes, but I'll try." Even though you have your own little family, you are willing to step in and help, knowing what we have lost in the last year and a half. And I wanted to take a moment to tell you Dad sees that, and he's got to be so proud of you, and we love you, and we appreciate you. How above and beyond you have gone. We love you all, and thank you for coming today to show our dad the love and respect he absolutely deserves.
Paul, 11 years separate us the day I was born. You have always been my big brother. My earliest memory of us is when I wanted to watch Mighty Mouse, and you wanted to watch MASH. So I cried to Mom, and being the baby of the family, I got my way. You never let me forget how much of a pain in the butt I was in our early years. But as we both grew older, especially in our adult years, I found myself looking up to you for your wisdom and advice in my major life decisions. Despite our natural brother rivalry, I've come to realize that our relationship was never about competition. Throughout my 45 years of life, not a single day passed that you were not there for me when I needed you the most. You filled the roles of both big brother and father figure to me, giving me advice that only someone who has known me my whole life can give. Through our egos, we may have clashed at times, but deep down, I always knew you were right. With your passing, a void has been left in my life that no one else can fill. I will always be grateful for all the love and support that you've given me through the years. You will be so deeply missed. I promise to keep your memory alive with the family and friends. You always had a smile on your face, and when we were together, we were always joking and making everybody else laugh. Today, I would like everyone here to remember that you are not alone, and you don't have to suffer in silence. I would like you to think of others in your life that may be suffering in silence, and reach out to them and tell them that you love them. Help me honor Paul's memory by encouraging everyone to speak up about mental health and offer help when needed. And let everyone know that it is okay to not be okay. My big brother, Paul Robitelli, I will always love you too.
It is with great honor that I am able to come up here and speak to you guys. As a son of a person who worked in law enforcement and served in the military, I've always had great respect for those who serve to protect us. Notwithstanding the current environment out there who likes to look down upon those that serve in the military or serve in law enforcement, we need to look up to those who serve in the military and law enforcement. But even more special today for me to speak about someone who served in law enforcement was to speak about someone who is my friend. I get to speak about someone not just because he served and protected, but he was my friend. About 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks ago, Paul walked in my office and said, "Hey, Judge, I'm going to be back in your courtroom again." And I said, "Great, you're coming back to the best." He said, yeah, I guess so. I said, no guessing, you are. When I first met Paul many years ago, I heard a knock on my door. And those of you who don't know, I had major back surgery years ago. When I'm not sitting in the courtroom, I have several different types of seats in my office. I got one where I can sit upright. I got a massage chair. I got an anti-gravity chair. I got a beanbag. I sit different ways to sit so that my back's not bothering me. And oftentimes, after hearings, I will sit in my office and stretch. You lay down on the ground. Well, I heard this little noise. And I'm on the ground stretching. And at first I thought it was Judge Estrada beating his head against the wall. And I said, I just ignored it. And because then I told myself, I said, that wasn't loud enough. Because if Judge Estrada was beating his head, it would be a lot louder. And then I thought it was my assistant pushing her cart. See, we have a ton of work. And I thought maybe she'd hit the wall with the cart. Because it happened the second time. And I just ignored it. Because, just because she's doing work, it doesn't mean I can't keep stretching. And then I heard her a third time. And I said, no, that's my door. Someone's knocking at my door. So I yelled out. I'm laying on the ground stretching. I yelled out and I said, who is it? Come in. And I don't hear anything. I heard the door open and someone says, Judge? And I said, I'm over here. Come on around. See, when you open the door, you couldn't see me if I was stretching on the ground. I was on the other side of this long table and he come walking in. He says, Judge, I'm here to check your alarm. Every Friday, they come and check the alarms. And so here I am, laid on the ground, stretching. I had all this work laying around me, because then I'd roll back over, and I'd be signing warrants, so hopefully it wasn't for any of you. And when he walks up, he doesn't really say anything. It was funny. He just stepped over me. He goes over to the alarm, checks it, and I'm watching him. He steps over me and walks back out. I was like, well, that was kind of odd. And I'm thinking, he's probably thinking, that's kind of odd. There's this fat judge laying on the ground, rolling around like a whale, And then the next week, he was in my courtroom. And if you ever saw Paul in a courtroom, he put his arms like this on his gun belt, and he'd look back and he would stare. And I look over at him, and I'm like, he's kind of scary, I'm like, his first time he's in my courtroom. Soon as court was done, I run upstairs, I call my brother, Chris, who works at the sheriff's department, and I said, Chris, I said, I got this new guy, this new bailiff who's coming into my courtroom. I said, he's kind of odd. I said, he stood there, just this stare, which I'm sure it kind of scared some of the people, but it kind of scared me. And I said, what can you tell me about this guy? He goes, well, who is he? I said, he's kind of tall, he wears glasses. I think his name is like Ravioli or Rigatoni, something like that. And he goes, oh, Robitelli. He said, Robo. He said, he's a great guy. You need to get to know him. So I did get to know him. And we began to talk. I'm going to tell you about the characteristics of Paul Robitelli. Paul was a protector. Psalms 144:1, King David is speaking, said, praise be to the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war, my fingers for battle. Paul would stand in front of my bench, with his back against it, looking out, there to protect me. Okay? That was his job. And he looked out at individuals, and he ensured that I was protected. He was a protector at home. For those of you who don't know this, he was kind of a prepper, kind of like me. And he's loading up with guns and ammunition and stuff to protect his family. He told me, no one is going to hurt my family. God tells us as men to be protectors of our family. And Paul was that. John Piper, a great theologian, pastor, chancellor of Bethlehem College and Seminary, said this. When you hear a noise in your house, this is what he said. to all men. Listen to me, men. Even if your wife is a black belt, or we can change it a little bit, even if your wife serves in law enforcement, you go first. You better be unconscious before she intervenes. That's written on your soul, brother, by God Almighty. Big or little, strong or weak, night or day, you go up against the enemy first. That was Paul. Paul wanted to go up against the enemy first. Paul was a provider. 1 Timothy 5:8. Got my cards out of order. 1 Timothy 5:8. If anyone does not provide for his relatives, especially for his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Men, work. I'm tired of hearing this. I'm tired of seeing it every day at first appearance. Men who don't work, who don't provide for their family. Paul provided for his family. Paul had a great nest egg. Paul worked overtime. My brother told me how much Paul would ask to work overtime. He was providing for his family. Paul was also a professional. Colossians 3:23 says this, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men. You know, in the years that I worked with Paul, I never had to tell him to pay attention. I never had to tell him, hey, get a hold of that defendant and get him out. Paul was on it. He was a professional. And I never heard him talk nasty to anyone. He was a professional. And you know, we can be a provider. We can be a protector. And we can even be professional with those we work with. But here's the last thing Paul was. He was pleasant. The Bible tells us in Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Just as someone else said, Paul would get to the courthouse early, and he would be at the door welcoming people in. He would have his classic rock playing, and he would stand at that door and hold the door for others to come in. And he would greet them with love. He was always pleasant. I never had him come to me. Yes, I'm a judge. Him and I would talk in my office. Him and I would talk in the hallways. Him and I would talk outside. He would greet me at my car. Believe it or not, I'm forgetful. Sometimes I leave my keys for the courthouse. And one of two bailiffs would come and meet me at the door. Paul was one of them. And he always left. You forgot your keys again. Well, thank you, Paul. But he was always pleasant. He was always pleasant. Now, only God knows the soul of man. But I'm going to tell you this. Paul showed the qualities of a Christian man. He was a provider. He was a protector. He was professional, and he was pleasant. Just think how better our society would be if men would stand up and be those. How many men nowadays are not providers? Instead, they're takers. Who are not protectors and instead are abusers. Who are not professional. Instead, they are just jerks. Or who are not pleasant. They talk to their wives like they're trash. They talk to workers like they're pieces of trash. Do you know that many defendants today, as of yesterday, were talking about how much they are missing Paul? Do you know that? So not only did people that he worked with knew he was a great man, people he had to hold in custody knew he was a great man. We need more Pauls. We need more Pauls. And what we need to be is be Pauls and make sure your heart is close to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Morning. I'd like to begin by thanking everybody who's responsible for putting today's celebration for Paul together. I also want to thank those from everyone from Bible Fellowship for allowing us to gather here today. My name is Kenny Young. I'm a fellow bailiff and just one of many Paul's friends. I'd like to acknowledge and recognize Paul's family, Paul's parents, Gladys, Paul Sr., his siblings, Karen, Matt, Holly, and Heidi, Paul's daughters, Jessica, Krista, and Ashley, with their husbands, Alan, Johnny, and Dominic, Paul's cherished grandchildren, Kyler, Brian, and Luca. I would have countless conversations with Paul, talking about how proud he was of his family. Paul recently looked forward to his workouts with his brother-in-law and his nephew. As I stood in the hall, I recognized that it wasn't just Paul's immediate family. He's got extended family here, too, and I'd like to recognize you all, too. To Paul's mom and dad, he loved you much. He said he'd always try to be there for you both. To Tammy, Paul referred to you as Mama Bear. He said you would much rather spend time with your family than go to some fancy place. That your heart is with your children and your grandchildren. I first met Tammy at the makeshift memorial that Mike Weed and Paul's daughters, Krista and Ashley, set up outside the courthouse. Tammy repeated stories Paul would talk about, how no one believed she existed because no one ever met her. She talked about our Halloween parties. Paul wanted her to go, and Tammy would tell him, I've got nothing to wear. Paul replied, you can always come dressed as my wife. Paul loved our Halloween parties. He started planning his costume in March. To Karen, Paul said you were a walking medical miracle and you're tough as nails. Matt, a conversation with your brother, I was aware of your age difference and also knew you guys were close. Paul did take credit for your career, though. But he said you surpassed him in your knowledge and all your certifications. He was proud of you. And on a quick note, I didn't recognize you when you came in the other day. You had a hat on. You look like the exterminator guy. Jesse, Chris, and Ashley, you know I don't need to tell you how you filled your father's heart. If he could, he would have given you the world. I do recall a story. Your dad said one time you attempted to leave the house wearing your volleyball shorts. What was you thinking, Ashley? You know, Krista, you're now part of our family at the courthouse. We might be a family of misfits, but you're welcome. I learned Thursday that we had 10-minute limit to talk about Paul, and that's understandable. And I said to myself, how am I going to fit Paul into 10 minutes? I was going to tell stories like how he purchased Sabrina a pair of bedazzled socks just to win her over on our socks and slide debate. The day Jennifer wore her bachelorette paraphernalia, Paul commented how he was so happy seeing how happy Jennifer was. It reminded him of his daughter's excitement. Paul gave Jennifer money for lunch that day and told her if she ever got divorced, he had to pay her back. the meme wars between Tony Ford, Todd Turner, and Sam Wilson. They were intense. It'd be hard to crown a true winner. I told Paul I chose not to play in your reindeer meme games. Not a minute later, my phone would get a notification. It's a picture of my face on a naked statue of a god Greek. The statue was pretty accurate. I looked, and there was Paul sitting with that big smile on his face. I was going to talk about Paul's music playlist, which consisted of everything, rock, hip-hop, country to rap. No, really, Paul can actually rap. It was weird. He would know almost every lyric to all the songs, but he couldn't tell you who sang them. It was a running joke amongst us when we'd ask Paul, who sings this? Paul would always say, Kiss. He was right that one time when Kiss was playing. On occasion, you hear a song, Pour Some Sugar on Me playing on Paul's phone as the clerks would come in, start the morning. I got to tell this whole story because Paul never laughed so hard. I don't know if you all know Mr. Albritton. Mr. Albritton started with the sheriff's office in the early 70s, and Paul looked up to him. He admired Mr. Albritton. I don't know if you know Mr. Albritton, but they stand 6'2". He wears a tailored uniform. He still has some pythons on his arms. And Paul really looked up to him. And he would work with us at Front Security. And there's one day I was explaining to Mr. Albritton how I was growing my hair out. It only grew on the sides. But the plan was to get something on top. And Paul was all for it because if it worked for you, he was doing it. So we explained this story to Mr. Albritton. And as I said it, I said, Mr. Albritton, I'm a trendsetter. Now, I can't imitate Mr. Albritton's slow southern draw with my Jersey twang, but he said something like this. Well, Kenny, if you want to be a transgender, that's your opinion. Paul almost hit the floor. He had tears in his eyes trying to explain to Mr. Albritton. He said, trendsetter. How Paul and I both had our ringtones set to Thunder by Imagine Dragons. And when the phone would go off, we know it was Mike Weed calling. We're going to miss him cooking us breakfast in the morning. On occasion, Paul would whip up his specialty, ramen and eggs. Ex-Sergeant Myers, he can attest to how that tasted. I asked if I had just a little bit more time to tell one story because I thought it was pretty important. You guys don't know the heart of Paul. There was a gentleman and his son who was living in his car outside of a restaurant. And Paul would go there every night and ensure that boy had something to eat. Paul also ensured that boy had shoes to wear for school. And then he bought him a Christmas gift. I got it right here in big letters. It says, Paul wouldn't want me to stop here to check if Christina was still here or if she was on a bathroom break. Still here? When Paul moved over from detention, it wasn't long before he and I bonded. Paul said, you know, Kenny, I don't know what it is. I just click with you. I said, I know. Maybe it's a northern thing. Paul was from Massachusetts, and I grew up in Jersey. When Paul would speak to me about his family, he would refer to me as his partner. Not in today's woke terms. More like Adam 12, Starsky and Hutch. John and Ponch from Chips, and I definitely play Ponch. I was talking to Lieutenant Ludden, reminiscing about Paul, and it struck me. I said to him, to me, Paul is the definition of a genuine human being. He connected to people. He connected to everyone. Everyone in this room, that's the reason why you're here. You're here because Paul connected with you. He connected with Sam Bearholt, or who we affectionately call Grumpy Cat. Sam and Paul loved to cook, and they'd share recipes. Kevin Smith connected by their weight loss success. Eric Porter would be about FRS and TikTok videos. With Sharon, it'd be some fasting program she was doing, or the status of her mentally challenged cat. with Juan de Gello, Juan Delgado. It was about firearms and his expertise. Mike Helms, it would be about Mike's son and how his recovery was doing. Chris Carr told me he connected with Paul with Hey Dude Shoes. These guys even had a Hey Dude app. The first call I got was from Captain McGann. He said, "You're the first person I thought to when I got the news." Captain McGann wasn't even in the state. He was in the airport in Texas with his son, Liam. I started receiving text messages. Ulyssa, Brooke, Jesse, Glenda, Becca, Rachel, Christina, Debbie, Sly, and Denise Wilcox. Chris Carr and Tony Ford knew how close Paul and I were, made sure they covered the front entrance of the courthouse for me. Lieutenant Gonzalez and Captain Johnson knew how close we were and allowed me to take some time off. I received phone calls and texts from folks who wear the green uniform. I even received calls and texts from folks I served with who wore different uniforms. What you all of you do not realize, my relation Paul was not unique just to me. He was this way with all of you. I was just the lucky one to spend the most time with him. Carrie sent me this quote: "Death leaves a heartache no one can heal, but love leaves a memory no one can steal." I know, like many of you, we've had many conversations with Paul since last week. I had one with Paul when I was watering the flowers in the yard, and I felt the heartache begin to set in. I remembered a song from church this past Sunday. The song is called "I Speak Jesus." I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Maybe this song might bring you peace. There's plenty of eulogies where people say heaven was short of an angel, and that's why a loved one was taken. But heaven wasn't short an angel this time. It was short a mountain of a man with a heart of gold and a gift of giving. People told me that this was going to be hard for me to come up here and speak. I said, "No, I was just pretending to have a conversation with Paul, and you overhear it. I love you, Paul."
The Highlands County Honor Guard is going to present the honors. Tammy, as we celebrate Paul, we know that behind every great man was an amazing woman. So as they talk about your man, There are many, many lives in here that will never be the same because of him. To those of you that are in green, thank you from the bottom of our hearts for what you do. For all of us, and it's been said a couple times, ask the question. Ask someone, how are they doing? When they smile at you and say, okay, then you can ask another question. Now tell me the truth, please. On this day, there are no words that we can say to make this better. As we close our time together, I'm going to read you a passage of scripture. As we leave here, all of us are going to have choices to make on what we do with our grief and the loss. I would say to you, be very, very careful. The world will try to help you in a lot of different ways. And it might mask the pain. But so far, I haven't found anything that the world has to offer to deal with the pain. But I have found this. And when I found this, my life has never been the same. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Kenny, I want to thank you. I'm not sure where you went for that song, Give Me Jesus. Once you have Jesus, you have life. I'm going to close in prayer. We're going to ask the family to be dismissed. I would ask you all to stand when the family leaves. There is one psalm that we're going to close our time together. And those that are going to make the wall are going to head that way. And you are invited to come to have some snacks on that side. Fill out the 3x5 card of your favorite memory of Paul. Jesus, we gather today with heavy hearts. Because someone that loved us is no longer here. And so I pray for the family. That as they grieve and as they process, that you would allow them some hope and some peace of heart and soul. They didn't do anything wrong. And so as they laugh and cry and travel, there is something that is true that Kenny shared, that you can't steal a memory of love. So would you take those memories and mold and shape their heart? I think of the individuals that have been helped by Paul, from prison to someone on the side of the road that's just homeless. What an incredible challenge for us to see someone other than ourselves, that we love well, that we care for the people around us. So Jesus, on this day, would you allow individuals to run to you for hope and comfort? Would you restore souls the way that only you can, Jesus? Thank you for some time with Paul. So now help us as we go on without him. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us, please? Nancy's going to play that song. Thank you.
drug on and on. We were loading up that Chevy, both trying not to cry. Mama kept on talking, putting off goodbye. Then she took my hand and said, baby, don't forget. Before you hit the highway, you better stop for gas. And there's a 50 in the ashtray in case you run short on cash. Here's a map and here's a Bible.
For those of you that parked down the road on the other side of that entrance, please be very careful when you back out of here because the Hammock Road is crazy. So we try to get everybody parked in the back. I know some parked on the other side. So just be careful as you exit. Again, we'd like to invite you. We'll just kind of let some of the funeral home will kind of dismiss us. Thanks again for being here for their family.
Haven't done this in a while.